it's finally here, the first 5G iPhone. So unless you missed the announcement, Apple's new iPhone 12 lineup will have 5G capabilities. But what does that actually mean for everyday users, and how will it change the rate of 5G deployment? Stick around. Hey everyone, welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Juliet Beauchamp, and I'm here, as always, with Macworld senior writer Michael Simon, as well as Computerworld executive editor Ken Mingis. So like I said, guys, you know, unless the two of you were living under rocks, I'm positive that you guys saw the new iPhone announcement. And there's a lot of new
features. I had
features
no choice.
Coming.
I had a choice, but I watched it for sure, yeah.
And so there's a lot of new and exciting features coming to the iPhone 12. And we can go over some of those are briefly, but I think probably one of the biggest and most exciting developments for, you know, mobile phones, smartphones, for mobile development in general is, of course, 5G, the next generation of wireless. So can we go over?
This sounds like suspiciously like a Verizon advertisement.
I was just going to say, I enjoyed the Verizon commercial with a little bit of Apple thrown in the other.
Yeah, it was I don't know, just very sleazy and very un-Apple-like.
It really was.
They clearly had to work with Verizon and AT&T, and I guess not T-Mobile, to get their, specifically Verizon, because they usually charge more for their bands, so to speak, to get their bands hooked up with the 5G modem. Most Android phones are $100 more for millimeter wave if you get it through Verizon. And Apple's not doing that, well, as such. The lower phones are $30 more for whatever reason, as we learned, not from Apple, but by going to the iPhone order page. If you order an unlocked iPhone 12 with 5G, of course, you can't get it without. It's iPhone 12 mini, it's $729. If you order it through Verizon and AT&T, through Apple, you know, pick the I have Verizon box, you get a special carrier discount of $30.
I saw that on the order site. I wondered why AT&T is doing something similar too.
Same thing, yes. They both have it. T-Mobile does not. So you got to pay $729 through T-Mobile. And it brings it down to the advertised price of $699, which is just, I expect that from, not to point fingers, but I'm just going to throw out names like Samsung, LG. They work a lot closer with the carriers, and the carriers dictate more of those terms, for better or worse. Apple, from the beginning, you know, they don't really do that. Yes, it was exclusive to AT&T or Singular in the very beginning, but recently, you know, for the last, I don't know how many releases, 6, 7, 8, you know, they say, this is it. This is the price. This is what you're paying. And you know, the carriers do their BOGO stuff and the line stuff, but that's their own stuff. This is on Apple's website. They're advertising it as a carrier discount through AT&T and Verizon. And it's very surprising.
Yeah. You know, to Juliet, I just want to get back to the 5G thing for one second in terms of what it's going to change. And I think the answer.
Oh, did I get off topic? I'm sorry.
Well, no, you're on topic, but I, you know, the initial question was,
I have axes to grind, Ken.
Yes, you do. Let me pull you back in. No, but in terms of like, okay, so I, of course, you know, am interested in getting one of the new iPhones. The 5G part of it is not really a big part of the equation because I guess maybe educated consumer, understand that the 5G networks that are out there, the access that I will have, is not what's coming. You know,
yeah,
I mean,
well, what carrier do you have?
AT&T.
Okay, so there is a nationwide, you know, in big giant air quotes, a nationwide 5G network on all three carriers right now. AT&T has one, mixed with millimeter wave in some places. T-Mobile was the first. They came out with theirs last year, and it's the widest. They cover about 250 million people, so they say. And Verizon at the Apple event just announced their, you know, nationwide network. It's pretty spotty based on the map that they have on their website, and it's mixed in with that millimeter wave stuff, which they're expanding, but it's very limited. And you're right. 5G right now is not a great robust network. And if you don't have a plan that supports it, which is one of the newer unlimited plans on one of these carriers, you're going to pay more because like I looked mine up. So I have an old Verizon. I have a 12 gig or 10 gig. I forget the plan, but I've had it for years. And you get kind of grandfathered into those plans as they, you know, they're constantly changing these things around and offering new plans, but they don't force you to switch, just like cable. You know, you get kind of grandfathered into those old plans. but you don't get any of the new stuff. So if I want 5G, I got to dump that plan, sign on to an unlimited plan, which is going to cost me like $50 extra a month.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, this is clearly the carriers are going to use the advent of 5G, the arrival of 5G to extract more money from customers. You know,
yeah, they keep saying that they're not, mm-hmm. but they are. You know, it is included, but you have to have one of the newer unlimited plans, which
for a nominal fee. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, but you know, to your another one of the points I think you were making, Juliet, is that now that Apple's on the scene, I mean, this doesn't surprise anyone. We've all known that a 5G iPhone was coming. You know, assumed that it was coming for a year or two. Mm-hmm. You know, there was even some talk there might be one next year. I don't know that the networks, especially in this era of pandemic and everything that's going on, could be rolling it out any quicker. I don't think they were waiting for Apple to arrive with a 5G phone.
Verizon was, because they just announced theirs on Tuesday.
Well, that's why they wanted to wait for the announcement. Okay, they wanted to wait for the Apple, you know, commercial to get involved. Yeah. But maybe other than Verizon, I don't think that you know, it will have an effect. There are a lot of iPhone users. It's important that they're on board, but not immediately.
The number of devices that can access a 5G network is going to double by the end of the year. There's no other, I mean, I don't have hard and fast numbers, but assuming Apple sells 30 to 40 million iPhone 12s in the holiday quarter, that's about probably how many smartphones are out there now. So it's going to roughly double, and that's it's huge. So that it's bringing it mainstream. But as you say, Ken, I don't know that they can do this much quicker. The spectrum has to be there. The work has to be there. And, you know, let's face it, it has to be monetarily advantageous to these carriers. They're not going to invest in something that, you know, isn't going to pay off. And until there's a heavy interest from consumers to buy these plans, these newer plans, and to get 4 or 5G, they're going to go at the pace that they're going.
Well, it's the tip. Go ahead, Juliet. Sorry.
Yeah, I'm curious from maybe for like an everyday consumer, you know, if your iPhone is due for an upgrade and you're interested in upgrading, I know I have family members who their like iPhone 7s and 8s are just on their last legs. They're ready to go. Is the iPhone 12, you're going to want the newest and greatest. So is getting a 5G enabled phone, you know, whether you're getting, you know, the new Google Pixel or the new Samsung phone, or you're getting the new iPhone, is it sort of, you know, a 5G insurance policy, knowing that, you know, one day within, you know, the next, you know, standard 2-year contract of my phone, or like, you know, 2-year payoff period, I will be able to use those 5G speeds.
For sure. And some get it now. Like if I had T-Mobile, I could get, I've tested them. They're not great. It's that sub 6 gigahertz network and it's still being built out. And it's about, you know, 50% faster than LTE. It's there. Is it worth paying for if you don't get it already? Probably not. Is it worth rushing out to buy an iPhone for that? No. That said, the iPhone 12 is very nice. Has a lot of great features. It's so if you're upgrading, if you're on the upgrade program from last year, go ahead. If you have a 7 or an 8 or a 10, by all means. The 5G is nice to have. It's future-proofing. Mm-hmm. You know, I was surprised that Apple went so heavy into it. Like they were really pushing it. This is it. 5G is here. That high-speed mono, that was strictly 5G. They were all about it.
Yeah, I kind of wondered about that too, because I do think there's a bit of a possibility that people will be getting these phones because Apple has made such a big deal about it, expecting blazing fast, incredible, you know, coverage, et cetera. And they're not going to get that, you know, depending on where they are. And I mean, I get that Apple, again, in tandem with Verizon, wanted to play this up. It is a big deal. I think it's important for them to talk about it. But I think a lot of people who think they're going to get this new phone and suddenly their life is going to change, you know, maybe disappointed. And now in 6 months or a year, you know, to your original point, I wouldn't buy a phone now that wasn't 5G enabled, because it is what's coming.
Sure. Maybe.
Yeah. Maybe you would. How about a 3G? Would you buy a 3G?
Well, that's a little, it's a little different.
Okay.
The jump from 3G to 4G was massive. The jump from 4G to 5G right now is, you know, okay. It's going to take some time. If somebody had $400 to spend and wanted to buy an iPhone SE, or $500 to spend and wanted to buy an iPhone XR, I wouldn't dissuade them. I don't think you're going to miss out on too much in the next 2 to 3 years. And then by the time, you know, a couple of years from now, then you can upgrade to a 5G. You won't be able to not. You know, I mean, I criticized Samsung last year quite a bit for releasing these ridiculously expensive 5G phones. They were $1,500 and up. They were, you know, a lot, and they played them up as these big giant, you know, luxury devices, and they were. Now I'm wondering, maybe that was the right tack to take, because you're selling that phone to an enthusiast, someone who knows what they're getting and why they're getting it. Apple is saying, okay, 5G is here. It's all over their website. And like my dad called me up and asked me like, well, what do I do? I'm like, well, you don't do anything, because unless you want to spend another $60 a month, he has an old plan too. He has a 2 gig plan. Like, they don't even have that anymore. I'm like, unless you want to spend a lot more a month, you're not buying this phone for 5G. Now, listen, most parents don't have access to a Macworld expert. So what are they supposed to do?
They go out and buy a 5G phone and then wonder why it's no different from the last phone they had.
That's exactly right. Most people, most of the time, are going to be on LTE. And that's it.
I think, too, what's important to remember about, I mean, 5G is going to be, it's going to be really fast, and it's going to be great, you know, if, you know, we're fortunate enough to live in more populated cities, but 5G is going to be huge for rural communities. And if
maybe, I mean, we were told LTE was going to be huge for rural communities.
Sure.
So a lot of us don't have it yet.
So allegedly 5G is going to be very beneficial to rural communities. But if, you know, you don't have millimeter wave in rural communities yet, you're probably better off working off of, you know, Wi-Fi. So if I have a 5G phone, you're better off working off of Wi-Fi at the very least if you're in a populated city too. Because if I've got a 5G enabled phone, I'm working from home all day long. Not everyone is fortunate enough to be in that position. But, you know, what's the difference between T-Mobile speeds, for example, to, you know, your run-of-the-mill Wi-Fi plan if I'm home?
They're pretty close. You know, assuming run-of-the-mill Wi-Fi is about 50 megabits per second.
Yeah.
T-Mobile delivers about twice that, you know, on an average.
But we should note, though, Wi-Fi, you're more likely, if you've got a lot of bandwidth on your Wi-Fi, you're likely to see better speeds there than you would even on 5G.
I mean, maybe 5G, that's one of the benefits, is that it has tremendous bandwidth. In fact, the millimeter wave stuff that Verizon's deploying, the best use of that is going to be if we ever get back to, like, you know, stadiums and concerts and ballparks inside of those areas where you have 50,000 people and, you know, 20,000 of them are on Verizon, you'll be able to connect to 5G and send things and text and send videos and images super fast, because the bandwidth is tremendous on 5G.
I did notice a lot of caveats sprinkled throughout the Apple thing, you know, about, like, in these particular conditions,
well,
it's going to be
should.
Amazing.
The whole thing.
I know. And that's what we're here for.
The high speed mono should have had an asterisk, so, you know, in peak times or optimal conditions.
Related, but different. I did notice that the new phones have Wi-Fi 6.
They did.
Should anyone care about that?
The old ones did too.
Okay.
I mean, I care because I have a Wi-Fi 6 router. That's more future proofing. They're starting to come out now. The prices are starting to come down. I spent a ridiculous amount of money on mine, but I love it, and I wouldn't have it any other way. But Wi-Fi 6 it's awesome. And once those things reach, like, the Google Wi-Fi is Wi-Fi 5 still. The Amazon just came out with Eero Wi-Fi 6. Like, they're reaching the lower levels. A couple of years, once that comes out, Wi-Fi 6 is a pretty big jump over Wi-Fi 5 or AC, as they used to call it. Now they finally got into smart nomenclature.
Okay, I have to ask real quick, because I know we have to go soon, but I'm not a dad, and I'm not on a 2 gig plan, but if I was choosing between an iPhone Pro and an iPhone Pro Max, iPhone 12 Pro, 12 Pro Max.
You mean the two pros?
Michael, the two pros, yeah. What would you choose? I've got an iPhone 11 Pro Max now.
Personally,
Do I go big or small?
Well, I mean, it depends on what you want.
They're practically the same
size-wise.
Yeah.
Well, they're not. The Pro Max, Apple did some things there, and it's surprising. It has a 5x optical zoom versus 4x, which is not huge, but it's something. And the wide-angle lens has a better low-light sensor. So you're taking better photos in darkness than you would with the Pro. They're small, little, subtle things, but, you know, if you can handle the size, I would definitely go for the Pro Max, because you're getting a little better camera. For $100, better screen, bigger screen, better camera. I personally want the smaller one because that's just too big. I've tested all these phones, these Ultras, S20 Ultra, Note 20 Ultra. They're too big. I've had it. I like that Apple came out with that mini because that's the direction we should be going. Go lower, backwards.
Yeah. Well, that's actually where I'm at because I can go slightly larger or slightly smaller, and I had the iPhone 10, and that to me felt like the perfect size in the hand. Yeah. You know, and then I went back to the larger phone, and I'm really dithering as to what whether to go Pro Max.
If you think that's perfect, then the 6.1 is going to be it's basically the same size because they trimmed those bezels, so it's basically the same as the 5.8 inch 10. They're extraordinarily similar. We're talking about like tenths of a millimeter between them.
All right. So we'll have to tune in next week to see what I get then.
I'm on the edge of my seat.
I know you are.
I'm sure everyone is.
I'm getting the 12 non-pro. It's a little, it's $100 more than last year, which to be expected because it has the OLED screen. It has the 5G and it has both flavors of 5G, the millimeter wave and the sub six. You know, Apple could have, maybe should have cut that off at the Pro, had the Pro be millimeter wave and the non-Pro not be. And then that might have been they might have been able to bring it down to 749. It's fine. It's still a good price. And then the Mini slides in at that $699/$729 price. So, the pricing is solid because I've seen on Android, these things get very expensive with 5G. And also cool is that the displays are identical now. Like it's not.
Yeah, I noticed that. They did a really good job. Everything's OLED, right?
Everything's OLED and they're the same OLED. Like they could have had the Pro Display XDR and then the Pro Display Retina HD or something. And, tweak stuff. They didn't. It's the same across the board when they're gorgeous. I mean, they're the best screens in the business. They're very nice.
What color do you like on the phones?
That blue is really nice. Both of them.
Yeah.
The blue Pro and the blue non-Pro, they're that kind of hue. I don't know what you call it. They call it Pacific blue, whatever that means. I guess it's like the ocean.
It's sort of the dark tealy blue.
Yeah, it's they're nice.
Okay, good. Now I feel informed.
From the Macworld expert himself. Well, thank you both so much for calling.
That gets an asterisk too, by the way.
Thank you so much, as always. It's really, I think, we talk about 5G so much here on the channel, and I think 5G was 2020 was sort of billed as 5G's landmark year. It seems like that's not really happening, but exciting to see 5G.
We do have all three major carriers.
Sure.
Nationwide networks. That's something.
That is something.
And listen, once Apple does it, it's a thing.
Maybe
so
I should
see what 2021 brings.
I'll be a little less skeptical. I'll give them a little more credit. Thank you both so much, as always, for calling in and joining me. And thank you all so much for watching this episode of Today in Tech. If you liked this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon in the corner so you're notified every single time we post a new video. If you have any thoughts, questions, comments about 5G, is, the iPhone announcement really going to push you to buy a 5G phone? Let us know. Or maybe it's doing the opposite. You're going to hang on to your LTE phone for a few more years. Let me know in the comments below. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next time.